invite your participation in helping us have a successful live stream by not connecting your phones to the Wi-Fi so that we have enough bandwidth to stream. It's very limited here, and we know that there are folks around the country who want to participate with us virtually, so just heed that. It would be wonderful if we could have that bandwidth. Thank you.
There you go.
really felt like a brand new room as we start clapping. Debt is not too high a price to pay for having lived. Mountains never die, nor do the seas or rocks or in the sky. Through countless centuries of time, they stay eternal, deathless. Yet they never live. If choice there were, I would not hesitate to choose mortality. Whatever fate demanded in return for life I give, for never to have seen the fertile plains, nor heard the winds, nor felt the warm sun on sands beside the salty sea, nor touched the hands of those I love. Without these, all the grains of timelessness would not be worth one day of living and of loving, come what may. I am Reverend Vernie Storm, retired co-pastor of Broadway United Methodist Church. And it's with celebration and sadness that we gather to pay tribute to such a wonderful pastor, spouse, father, grandfather, brother, uncle, mentor, friend, and justice seeker. We are called to this time and place to mourn, to remember, and to celebrate the sacredness of life. Before the wonder of living and dying, we are humbled. In the midst of sorrow and grief, we feel a river of both sadness and sacredness. Today, we grieve the death of Gregory Robert Dell, and we also celebrate the memory of his life and ministry. So I want to continue this celebration of one of his favorite songs, Amazing Grace. Red loved this song because the writer of this song realized the injustice of his actions as a slave trader and changed his ways. This song is the grace that moves this person to a different understanding of himself and of the humanity of others. Let us sing this song together and recommit ourselves to the grace that calls each of us to see the humanity of all. I invite you to rise in body and spirit, and let's sing together.
Thank you.
watching us from around the country. And thank Anna for the live streaming today. Their proximity is only that. We are feeling their closeness as we come together as community in this space. The witness of community is something the great shared at most weddings and memorial services. It's an opportunity for the gathered community to speak a word of blessing or story or hope. Because we have such a large, wonderful crowd, we have designated speakers to say a brief word. We invite anyone with a story or a memory to share, to submit it in a newly created website that is listed in the board's name. Gregory Robert Dell was born in Blue Island, Illinois, a southwest suburb of Chicago, on December 28, 1945, to Anthony, a railroad worker, police officer, and Jeanette, a church secretary. He has two younger sisters, Gloria, who now lives in Asheville, North Carolina, and Laura, who lives here in Evanston. Greg was a Boy Scout and spent many summers as a counselor, swimming coach, and sailing teacher at a Boy Scout camp in Benton Harbor, Michigan. He achieved the highest rank of Eagle Scout and always said that he would either be a professional scout or a pastor. The Dell family attended the Midlothian United Methodist Church beginning in the early 1960s, where the pastor preached about racism and the importance of fighting for social justice. Against his parents' wishes, Greg and his best friend from high school marched with Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. in Berlin. King was fighting for housing equity in the North. Greg remembered being spit on and screamed at by angry white mobs along the streets. In 1963, Greg left home to attend Illinois Wesleyan University on a theological scholarship, becoming the first person in his extended family to attend college. He met Jade Lurison on the very first day of classes, and they dated off and on until they graduated in 1967, got married, and moved to Durham, North Carolina to attend a divinity school at Duke University. There, Greg was nearly kicked out for organizing a service in the Duke Chapel following Dr. King's assassination. Greg received his Master of Divinity degree in 1970 and returned to Illinois to serve the community United Methodist Church in Naperville. In 1971, Jade and Greg's son, Jason, was born in Hillsdale at the closest hospital that would allow fathers to be present in the delivery room. Now we'll hear from Kathy Copeland, former member of Community United Methodist Church.
In 1970, Greg was a newly minted minister. He and Jade showed up at Community United Methodist Church for his first appointment. I was a 15-year-old member of the church. Greg attracted attention. He drove a red Mustang. He also rode a motorcycle. And I'm sure the length of his hair pushed right up against the tolerable limits in our liberalish but well-established congregation in a middle-class suburb. He had instant credibility with the youth. And he lost no time in engaging with us. Teenagers have a great radar for detecting authenticity. Greg was the real thing. He genuinely respected us and our thoughts and opinions. He accepted the crazy world of teenagers without condescending. He was expert at asking us difficult questions. He pushed us to think critically and always honored our responses. But most important, he gave us the tools to experience and struggle with community. Inspired by discussions with Greg, we took our disparate set of high schoolers and created our youth group as a covenant community. and we began a journey. It will be familiar break speak to most of you here. A covenant isn't a contract, it's much deeper and more complex. Creating a community, being a covenant, is hard. It's profound, it requires something deeper than compromise, it's not governed by majority rule. It requires listening, really listening, caring about people, as well as issues and positions. It requires holding ourselves and others accountable for our commitments. Greg set us off, but we ran with it, and we worked it with a passion. We worked it through, for example, the question of whether it was okay to go to the zoo as a group if one of us felt a moral obligation to caging animals. Yeah, sounds trivial, but we were earnest and passionate as teenagers at their best are, and it sparked what I think was hours of deep discussion. End result, we did not go to the zoo. And from the zoo incident and many others came lessons. Sometimes the one is more important than the many. Genuine dialogue takes time, but it's always worth it. You can be supported in community by those who don't personally share your point of view. Challenging each other to dig deep, think hard, and honor commitments brings out the best in all of us. It was insight we gained by doing, and because of that, it stuck. In the years since, whenever I've had the opportunity to talk with someone else from our group, we talk about this experience and how much it influenced our way in the world, our relationships, the communities we built, and our work for social justice. It is a gift from Greg that we will always carry.
In 1973, Greg was appointed to the Manuka United Methodist Church, a very active, small, rural congregation. On Tuesday mornings, he could be found sitting with the older women who met to weave rag rugs for missions. They always fed him pie. In 1977, Greg traveled to Cuba and learned about the challenges and successes of the Castro government firsthand. When he returned, he developed a slideshow program that painted a very different picture of Cuban life from what American newspapers were reporting. Some angry people came to heckle when he gave the program to the Manuka church community, but the people of the church stood up for Greg. Next, we will hear from Ruth and Jim Sartorius, members of Manuka United Methodist Church.
When I first met Greg, he did. He had the long hair. He looked like a hippie. He came to speak to a youth group of a combination of Shanahan and Manuka. I remember him talking about this covenant. I didn't appreciate it. I didn't agree with it. I was fresh out of the Marine Corps. It didn't make sense to me. I remember thinking, I hope we never get this guy. Came running up. We were standing next door where her mother lived, next door to the parsonage. And he came running up. I don't even know what he wanted to do, but he was very excited. Can I? And both of them turned to him and said, no. Well, then they looked at each other and said, no. Well, yeah, I guess it was okay. Whatever it was. But it taught, he said that was a lesson, because you can take a no, and you can change it to a yes, but try taking a yes and changing it to no. One is a no, the other, yes is a promise. You cannot change a promise. That was great.
Well, I could tell you many interesting stories about when he was at Manuka, like the time he and Jim were going to put a gas grill in. Each thought the other knew how to do it. Not true. Jane and I were just glad they didn't blow the parsonage up in the process. But I do want to say that Greg and Jane are godparents to all four of our children. Two of our children are here today. The other two live out of state and weren't able to make it. But our son Aaron, I think, described Greg very well in five simple words. He was a good man. And that he was. And we won't miss him terribly.
In 1974, Brent and Jade were founding members of a covenant group named Sisters, short for Sisters and Brothers. Meetings included spiritual study, reflection on social issues, collective donations to justice causes, protests, and volleyball. Many children, including Jason, grew up attending gatherings every summer and winter. After 42 years, the group is still meeting. Now we'll hear from Rebecca Pries, born into Cisbros and still a member.
So the children of Cisbros have had a unique relationship with Greg since we have been in this community since we were born. This meant that although many of us were pastor's kids who had to move around every couple of months or years, just like Greg, Cisbros and Greg were a constant for us. Cisbros met twice a year for 5 days. And when we gathered in the summers at Lake Geneva, during free time, Greg loved to sail in his little green sailboat, appropriately named Jake. He and I both loved the sense of adventure and freedom of being in that sailboat. The best part was when waves crashed over me when I sat on the bow of the boat. He trusted me to hang on when the bow was a little slippery, and maybe he shouldn't have. And I trusted him to sail safely through sometimes not the greatest weather. But this implicit trust defined our relationship. And relationships, I think, for many youth who grew up around Greg. It meant that he had respect for the importance of what we had to say. You could share anything, and he would not only help you hold it, but he would help you clarify it and find the words and the strength to act on it. In that sailboat, I began to find my voice. Later, as an adult, Greg told me how much he loved figuring me out, because I was a really quiet kid in larger groups. But Greg really loved being able to unlock kids and teens, and they were real with him in return. That was the greatest gift that they could give to him. Greg encouraged us to look at rules critically and live life fully. Sometimes this meant some rebellious fun, and he was lots of fun. We all have some great stories. And sometimes it meant doing what is right and not what the rules say. My first real job after college was as the director of an after-school program for low-income families in Humboldt Park, a predominantly Puerto Rican neighborhood, and a job that I had indirectly from Greg's influence. Cisbros steeped us in stories about crises and developments in Latin America, and after my own trip to Cuba with Cisbros, I decided to learn Spanish to be able to work with Latino communities in Chicago. At the after-school program, we had volunteers come a week at a time in the summers to lead activities with the kids. We had one group from United Methodist Church in the South. I bonded during the week with the youth minister over the United Methodist connection. Later in the week, he mentioned that the church here in the North was really different than the church in the South. And I knew exactly what he meant. Because at that time, Greg was currently suspended from the ministry, and it was national news. The youth pastor said, "Y'all have that pastor up here that's marrying the gays." I was proud to have found my voice in that moment to say that indeed we do. And that pastor is a close personal friend who later that month would be marrying my husband and I. And I said that although marrying two people who love each other is against the rules right now, it is the right thing to do. One of the greatest impacts Greg had on this world was helping to shape generations of youth.
In 1978, Greg, Jane, and Jason moved to Whedon United Methodist Church in Evanston. In 1980, Greg was invited to travel to Iran with a diverse delegation of 50 Americans in the midst of a hostage crisis. He was included in the group of 12 who met directly with the hostages, and he brought home letters and delivered them to families who lived in Illinois. Ed Bradley from 60 Minutes came to the Evanston Parsonage living room to do an interview with Greg the day after he got home. In 1983, the Weeding congregation voted to become a public sanctuary church for refugees from Central America. The church illegally harbored three men from El Salvador and Guatemala who had fled repressive regimes supported by the United States government, fearing for their lives. Later, Weeden became one of the first nuclear weapon-free zones and eventually also voted to become a reconciling congregation, welcoming gay and lesbian people into the full life and ministry of the church. Greg conducted his first same-sex holy union at Weeden. During his time in Evanston, Greg enjoyed sailing on Lake Michigan and also learned to scuba dive. He would later encourage Jason to also become a certified diver, and they were diving buddies on shipwrecks in Lake Michigan, kelp forests off Catalina Island, and coral reefs in Jamaica. Now we'll hear from Andy Gordon, former member of Weeden United Methodist Church.
Weeden was an activist church long before Greg got there. Under Al Streffler and other pastors, they housed activists, for example, in 1968 during the Democratic Convention. But Greg and Jake wrapped it up, always with a clear biblical focus. Thorough biblical grounding informed every activity for the church. Greg's invitation to communion was always an elaborate and instructive lesson applying the Bible to current circumstances. But there were discussions and debates about everything. How to word and reword the Lord's Prayer for inclusiveness and contemporary relevance, about whether Carol Larson was to be known as a lay leader, assistant minister, co-pastor. We debated everything. There was a deep discussion every Sunday after the sermon, often as long as the service itself, encouraging everybody to speak up, including, but not dominated, by Garrett Seminary faculty, Dick Thola, Jim Will, Doug Wingire, and occasionally Rosemary Reed. And so much political activity. I thought of Wheaton's activities under Greg as applied theology. The reports back from the Methodist Annual Conference were always about how our small church had pushed the Methodists to the left. To guide this congregation was like herding cats, except that Jaden, both Greg and Jade, relished not knowing what we would do next. A banner at the church read, "The sign of God is that we are led where we do not plan to go." An award was given to a person who accomplished 8 things before breakfast. And it was all very informal. There was one parishioner who was a businessman who always came to church in tattered jeans like so many other people. We happened to go to a grocery store a half hour later, and before he'd gone to the grocery store, he went home to get on his suit, which he thought would have been inappropriate for the church. And there was always such music, sometimes Jason and others playing horns, and typically with dancing with Jade leading the way. And the stands the church took were deliberately very public. I think they showed a slide of, and here's a picture of Jay, of Greg and Carol with this nuclear weapon-free sign that was on the lawn, often defaced, torn down, impacted by somebody in the community. It was designed by Linda Bear, and we tell ourselves that that is the design that made it around the world. And such great humor was coupled with this dynamic activity. I hear even now Greg's boisterous laughter when something caught his attention. We had a neighbor friend who didn't attend Weeden but was very supportive of the activities of the church and knew of its openness to gays and lesbians early on. And he set up a sign, it shouldn't say nuclear weapon-free zone, it should say nuclear family-free zone. Greg thought that was terrific. I am not alone now among those of you here, I'm sure, who would very much cherish Greg's advice and counsel about what we should do now, right now.
In 1985, Greg and family moved to Oak Park to join Euclid Avenue of the United Methodist Church. During Greg's pastoral appointment, Euclid adopted an inclusive language policy, became a reconciling congregation, and was one of the initiating congregations in the area's first homeless shelter program, Tri-Village PADS, now called Housing Forward. In 1987, Greg and Jane and Jason traveled to Nicaragua during the United States-funded Contra War. Again, they made the presentations all over Northern Illinois, sharing with local churches and communities what they had witnessed. In 1992, after many hours of lessons, Greg received his private pilot's license and enjoyed flying up and down the Chicago lakefront with family and friends. How many of us? In the 1980s and 90s, Greg made other international fact-finding trips to China, Israel, the West Bank, Lebanon, and Jordan. He was also arrested multiple times for acts of civil disobedience. Now we will hear from Randy Albers and Carl Rinder, members of Euclid Avenue United Methodist Church.
Greg didn't like quiet. So, we're celebrating a life lived fully. Let the people say,
Amen.
That's right. I first heard of Greg Dell in a Reader article about the Sanctuary Church at Wheaton. Imagine my surprise when we later moved to Oak Park and found that the pastor of the Methodist Church down the street was not other than Greg. I expected a giant of a man. Well, he was. He sure was not the way I anticipated. Under Greg's leadership, Euclid Methodist was dynamic, with young and old from a rainbow of races, ethnicities, genders, gender preferences, socioeconomic backgrounds, and belief systems. What do you know? Just like America. Mm-hmm. At least till the end of January. We didn't simply share an hour a week on Sunday mornings, but rather a vision of what the church and the world could be. Greg's apparently boundless energy enabled him to keep committees going, found a homeless shelter, travel with Jay to witness for justice, lead the creation of a reconciling congregation, do Broadway musicals, lock himself in with confirmation class for all-night vigils, and, along with another great pastor gone from us too soon, Larry Diefenhaber, started a ministry going. Along the way, he got his pilot's license, learned to scuba dive, and was arrested here. Greg didn't hide his human complexity. His likes and dislikes were intense, and he was sometimes down, but he always came back, never more so than during the tumult of the trial. I admire his honesty, courage, and fighting spirit. As you know, Greg loved to talk. He loved a good joke, a bad joke, chocolate, martinis, babies, fishing, more talk, and his church family. He also loved his own, especially Jason and the girls. And most of all, Jade. Without Jade's warm, steady presence, he would not have been the leader he was. He would not have built such deep friendships. Yes, Craig was passionate, especially about the power of love to heal the brokenness in ourselves and our world. I wish you were here to help us through the aftermath of this election. And go, where we saw vulnerability, energy, consciousness, living fully every minute, we often return to a poem by the 15th century Sufi poet Kabir. Friend, hope for the guest while you are alive. Jump into experience while you are alive. Think and think while you are alive. What you call salvation belongs to the time before death. If you don't break your ropes while you're alive, do you think ghosts will do it after? The idea that the soul will join with the ecstatic just because the body is rotten, that is all fantasy. What is found now is found then. If you find nothing now, you'll simply end up with an apartment in a city of death. If you make love with the divine now, in the next life, you will have the face of satisfied desire. So plunge into the truth, find out who the teacher is, believe in the great sound. Kabir says this, when the guest is being searched for, it is the intensity of the longing for the guest that does all the work. Look at me, and you will see a slave of that intensity.
My apologies, I have a cold, so it's going to sound like I'm paying tribute to Leonard Cohen. So the Parkinson's disease that afflicted him, that was real and terrible, doesn't get to have the last word.
Right.
Because Greg lived fully, meeting God face to face in everyone he came across, nurturing and challenging them. Disease and even death are quiet. Those same faces of God nurtured by Greg are here today, and they are beautiful, living on. And so here is the last word, as expressed by Raymond Carver. And did you get what you wanted from this life, even so? I did. And what did you want? To call myself beloved, to feel myself beloved on the earth.
Let the people say,
Amen.
In 1995, Greg was called to Broadway United Methodist Church in Chicago, a lively congregation in Lakeview, also known then as Boys Town, where about 30% of the congregation was gay or lesbian. In 1999, Greg faced an ecclesiastical trial for violating the United Methodist prohibition against conducting services of holy union for same-sex couples. He was found guilty of disobedience to the order and discipline of the United Methodist Church and suspended indefinitely from pastoral office. He was told that the suspension would end when he promised not to perform any more services. Greg, in conversation with Jade, steadfastly refused to do so. On appeal, the suspension was amended to 1 year, and he returned to Broadway over 6 more years of service. We'll hear now from Charlotte Little, member of Broadway United Methodist Church.
Amen.
Greg was our pastor for 11 years, a long time for a Methodist placement, it seems. In addition, I am fortunate to live across the street from the church, which makes for an easy commute. And it also means that the pastor and family are my neighbors. I remember my first unexpected introduction to Greg. It was brief as he walked through the church one evening when he was just checking us out. And I happened to be there and I thought, aha, so this is the guy. Greg and Jade accepted the placement, moved in, and we shared a first evening yard supper with them and our college age kids. And the tenure began. One of the first things that happened, we voted to become a reconciling congregation. All of us know how passionate Greg was in carrying out his call. There is no ally I know who has worked so hard within the church structure for the inclusive rights of the LGBT community and family. And we know his passion for equal ministry for all persons, as he officiated at gay marriages much before Broadway. But then the charges were brought against him while he was at Broadway, and yet he continued despite hierarchical resistance. As Greg's ministry at Broadway became known, the congregation grew. It became a gathering of many denominational backgrounds, many who felt disenfranchised and rejected from their own or any church and from God. But Greg was not afraid. He was intentional in our welcoming statement to say all are welcome and loved in God's house. And he would name each and every part of the community. If you are gay, lesbian, straight, queer, rich, poor, young, old, and on and on. Many have said that this is the first time that they have ever felt welcomed and called by name within a church. We continue that welcome each Sunday today. Thank you, Greg. Therefore, we had and have an array of church backgrounds and theology in our Methodist setting. Greg would say, we are the Mesopotamia of Chicago. And this wonderful mix have been folks who have felt the call to ordained ministry, but were not welcome to continue on their ordained journey in the church because of their sexual identity, and so were sidetracked to other careers. Greg counseled many and was inspired to begin a program, Candidates for Ordained Ministry. Candidates were charted through a program of discernment and study. They were asked to formally participate and lead ministries as interns at Broadway, and they were given opportunities to preach and worship. Ordination was the culmination of this work, and some of you participated in that program. Champion of inclusion, revolutionary, prophet, minister to all, and neighbor. When Greg needed a break from the office, he would mow the yard, prepare his fishing gear for Twin Lakes, or he might come across the street and check to see if my Bob was ready for a martini. Thank you. Greg would do the mixing, and they would lift their glasses and together salute life and Ogden Nash by quoting together, "There is something about a martini, a tingle remarkably present, a yellow martini, I wish I had one at present." And they would continue with the second verse together, and then enjoy some conversation on history or literature or the latest political scandal. During the years when the media was everywhere, showing up with cameras for our church service and interviewing Greg, I heard one reporter remark, "We love to interview that man, as we always come away with good sound bites." Yes, many of those bites became Greg's mantra, some for us too. Greg said and lived, intolerance of intolerance. May we practice and be faithful.
In 2000, the General Conference of the United Methodist Church tragically reaffirmed their homophobic stance, declaring that homosexuality was incompatible with Christian teaching. Many of us struggled to decide whether to leave the church in protest. Seeking a creative solution, Greg joined with other activists to establish an inclusive movement within the United Methodist Church. Church within a church, which was dedicated to creating safe and affirming space for LGBTQI persons, has evolved to an organization that works for all forms of inclusivity across race, ethnicity, gender, class, and sexual orientation. Now we'll hear from active member and co-treasurer of the Church Within a Church movement, along with Jade, Manny Ayemi.
Require a little bit.
Sorry.
It's on.
Can everybody hear me okay?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Great. I met Greg kind of late in life, 2005. We went to see him at probably United Methodist Church. And like the movie says, he had me up alone. The very first thing he said was speaking about tolerance, which is a word he didn't like very much.
Mm-hmm.
And he said, we don't tolerate people from diverse backgrounds here at Broadway. We celebrate.
All right.
And I knew we had found our home. Later, as we continued to work through Broadway and Church Within a Church, which is an organization that Greg helped to start along with Kathy, I got to know him a little bit better. But as he decided to accept the reality of his brush with Parkinson's, and told us he was leaving Broadway, I felt a keen sense of loss. So I sent him an email and I said, you know, I grieve the fact that we will not get to be friends because I feel that, you know, we could be. And he acted on that. He said, well, let's do it. So we started to get together for lunch every Thursday. And we did that for about 6 or 7 years. I was thrilled that in spite of his busy schedule, he would make time for just one individual. I was thrilled that he, you know, had access to somebody with such a background, such a mind, and such a way of thinking.
Yeah.
We would, you know, debate the finer points of theology as well as the indignities of growing old. And I always had fun doing it. And so what this developed into, when I was working downtown, he would meet me for lunch every Thursday. As he was unable to leave the house, I would meet him at his house, and we would go out to a restaurant around the area. When he had to go into the nursing home in Lincolnwood, I would go in and sit with him there. That's when our relationship, you know, evolved into the theology of movies. One of the things that Greg loved was movies, as did I, and I had great background in movies. So every time I brought him a good movie, we would sit and watch and talk about the points that we would bring up, about issues of justice in general. It was a fantastic time. We would have lunch, you know, and as the ravages of a disease took hold of him, sometimes, you know, he could do that. Sometimes he couldn't. There were days when we had some marvelous discussions. Other days we just kind of watched the movie and nodded at each other and enjoyed our ministry of presence.
Mm-hmm.
And there were other days when, you know, by the second hour, either one or the other or both of us would be fast asleep. And that was, you know, the greatest time of all. He moved away from Chicago, it was difficult, but I knew that he was, you know, taking steps forward, and I celebrated that as well.
Mm-hmm.
It's been a difficult year this year. I lost my father and then Greg in 2 consecutive months. And I would say this accordingly, that the two men were the most influence in my life.
Mm-hmm.
And it's easy to say, I do celebrate his life, but I miss him terribly. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Amen.
In 1997, Greg had the pleasure of performing the wedding for Jason and Tanya Osborne, who met in high school in Oak Park. They combined their last names to form Delborne and had two daughters, Olivia, born in 2000, and Ramona in 2004. Greg and Jay visited them often in California, Wisconsin, Minnesota, and Colorado. Greg relished his role as a grandpa and became known as Bubba to his family. In 2006, Greg was diagnosed with Parkinson's disease and went on disability in June of 2007. Greg and Jade left Broadway but stayed in Chicago in apartments near Logan Square. Greg fished often at a family cottage in Twin Lakes, Wisconsin. When Parkinson's symptoms worsened, Greg needed specialized nursing care and moved to Lincoln Wood Manor. In May of 2015, after Jade's retirement from Mount Sinai Hospital, Greg and Jade moved to Raleigh, North Carolina, to be near the Delborne family. There he celebrated his 70th birthday, saw his granddaughters play soccer and dance, celebrated his son receiving tenure at North Carolina State University, and deepened his relationship with Tanya, who cared for him as if he were her own father. He enjoyed movies, outings, air horn protests at the governor's mansion, and time and time and time and talks and time with Jade, devoted spouse, lover, confidant, comrade, wife, friend, forever friend. Greg's family, including his sisters Gloria and Laura, were with him during the last days of his life. At his death, Greg and Jade were married 49 years. Now we will hear from the Delborne family, Ramona, Olivia, Tanya, and Jason.
Dear Bubba, I think the first memory that I have of you is a small back speck falling from an airplane, which was you skydiving. Throughout your entire life, you were an adventurous and courageous man, and you taught me some things that I will always hold dear to. Number one, when I was 3, I received my first whining lesson, and I'd say after 16 years, I'm kind of an expert, because that's my parents. Number two, you can never eat too many cherry tomatoes or have too many cherry tomato eating contests. Lastly, and most importantly, you taught me to love, even when it is hard. And you taught me that a joke, a silly face, or even a fart machine can turn a room full of despair into one full of happiness and smiles. And for that, I am grateful. Oh. Dear Bubba, you got diagnosed with Parkinson's disease when I was 2 years old. One time, a few months ago, Mom and I went to a nursing home to visit with you. You were really upset and in pain. When Mom and I walked into the room, you didn't notice us. I said, "Hey, Bubba," and you jerked your head up at me and smiled. I went over to you and gave you a big hug, and I think you forgot about your pain. We went outside in the courtyard and played Make the Cloth Frisbee Land on Your Head. It was harder than we expected, so we gave up, and I placed it on your head like a beret. We laughed and took pictures, and when it was time to go, we helped you back to your room, the frisbee still on your head. When we got there, you said, "Let's put on a little music." So, of course, you put on an Italian grandpa song. I started doing a crazy dance, then Mom joined in. Then you started to move your feet and dance with us. We funeral laughing so hard. They always perked up when Olivia and I visited you. You always wanted to play with us.
Hi, I'm Tanya. I'm Greg's daughter-in-law, Greg and Jade's daughter-in-law. After Greg and Jade moved to North Carolina, we were able to spend lots of time together. And I noticed that Greg had a t-shirt that he wore so often that it was getting threadbare. The shirt said, "I have Parkinson's. It does not have me." Recently, I asked Ramona what she thought that meant, and she said Bub had Parkinson's, but he wasn't going to let it ruin his life. So simply explained. And then she said, even though it was. She's right. It's a simple concept for sure, but actually quite complicated. On one hand, I was in awe of the attitude of grace and determination that Bubba must have dedicated himself to in order to put that t-shirt on so often. On the other, I felt cynical and angry as I witnessed Parkinson slowly steal away the physical and mental abilities of one of the most articulate and intelligent people I had ever met. Mm-hmm. It was devastating. This summer, Greg's decline was severe, and by the end of the summer, he was unable to speak coherently in a way that the rest of us could understand. Almost exactly a month before he died, we were out on a beautiful lake with family. I was pushing Bubba's wheelchair, and in the midst of the family chatter, I heard him say quietly, "I'm dying." I stopped and sat down on the bench right in front of him and got right up close in his face. "What did you say?" I said. "I'm in the process of dying," he said quietly. He then, with a little difficulty, related a story to me about a parishioner he once had who gathered her loved ones around as she was dying and was able to tell each one of them what she loved and appreciated about each one of them. I repeated what he said back to him to make sure I got it right. He said, "Yep." "What a gift," I said. "Yep," he replied again. And then that moment of lucidity disappeared just as quickly as it had come. And it left me with a really heavy feeling. I knew that Bubba, being the ritual guy, was requesting or wishing for something similar. And I knew that Parkinson's had stolen too many of his abilities for a scene like that to actually be possible. I thought a lot about that and decided that even if Greg were still able to speak coherently, it would be very unlikely that there would be a big reveal. As most of us know, Greg wasn't one to hide how he was feeling about most things. He had already said what he would say to me many times, in many different ways. I decided that if he couldn't speak, I would just tell Bubba what I already knew whenever I spent time with him. Sometimes it was as simple as, "I love you, Bubba, and I know you love me, and I know you love girls." Sometimes more complicated, but the day before he died, he wasn't speaking at all anymore, and he really wasn't moving much either. But we had eye contact, and when I started talking about Olivia and Ramona, he was at full attention. I said, "Bubba, I know you are proud of the strong young women Olivia and Ramona are becoming." And he started waggling his eyebrows at me. "You love their wit, their self-confidence, their athleticism, and their ability to communicate so well." "Waggle, waggle, waggle, waggle." I said, "I see you waggling your eyebrows at me, Bubba. Jason and I are going to watch out for those girls, and they are going to experience so many things. Joy, sorrow, waggle, 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 waggle. Love, heartbreak, hilarity, despair, all the human emotions." Took my hand and he put it up to his heart. So today my wish is the same as Greg's. He wanted to gather us all up and tell us what he loved and respected about each of us. I'm saying he has already done so. Whether it's love yourself for who you are, stand up for what you believe in, honor that we all together, with all of our differences, make a beautiful garden of humanity. Celebrate. Chocolate. Maybe what he had to say to you was much more personal than that. My hope is that his message to you has been meaningful and that you carry it with you in your heart and with It's in this way that Parkinson's doesn't have the last word.
All right.
And Bubba's light and spirit prevail.
Yeah.
Focus his eyes, and he wasn't even waggling his eyebrows anymore. you and I knew him, and one of them dropped by his room and began singing hymns by his bedside. After a few minutes, she noticed that tears were streaming down my dad's cheeks from his unblinking eyes. Even in his last moments of life, my dad was living with intensity. I hope that for the rest of my life, my tears remind me to do the same. And let the people say,
amen.
Now that our throats are closed.
1971, I went to an Order of Barnabas meeting, and only a few people would remember that. That was the right wing of the Northern Illinois Conference organizing to oppose the Renewal Caucus. And soon after that, I went to an Aurora Council meeting, Council of Ministries, and the senior pastor who I was working with said about Greg when he spoke clearly about something, "That's a dangerous man." And the thing about the resurrection is that he's still dangerous. Our family met the Dell family in 1971. We could have met them 2 years earlier. I went as an intern to Columbia, Maryland, and there was another intern from University of Chicago, and there was supposed to be two interns from Duke, but Greg wouldn't go to an internship with somebody from Evangelical Theological Seminary. Me. Listen to these words from Isaiah. I don't know which of the three personalities of Isaiah this is, but also listen for how this passage helps us understand Greg, and also listen how Greg helps us understand this passage. On the contrary, this is the sort of fast that pleases me. Remove the chains of injustice, undo the ropes of the yoke, let those who are oppressed go free, and break every yoke you encounter. Share your bread with those who are hungry, and shelter homeless poor people. Clothe those who are naked, and don't hide from the needs of your own flesh and blood. Do this, and your light will shine like the dawn. And your healing will break forth like lightning. Your integrity will go before you, and the glory of Yahweh will be your rear guard. Cry, and Yahweh will answer. Call, and God will say, "I am here." Provided you remove from your midst all oppression, all finger-pointing, and all malicious talk. If you give yourself to the hungry and satisfy the needs of the afflicted, then your light will rise in the darkness, and your shadow will become like noon. Yahweh will always guide you, giving relief in the desert places. God will give you strength to your bones, and you will be like a water garden, like a spring of water, whose waters never run dry. You will rebuild the ancient ruins and build upon age-old foundations. You will be called repairer of broken walls and restorer of ruined neighborhoods.
We are a diverse community, one that does not tolerate people. Tolerance is an attitude we reserve for that which is unpleasant but necessary. We are not tolerated in this community. We are celebrated. We celebrate that we are black, brown, white, all the colors of God's creative rainbow. We celebrate that we are gay, straight, lesbian, bisexual, asexual, queer, and questioning. We celebrate that we are female, agender, transgender, gender nonconforming, and male. This time of community and connection is a time when we recognize and affirm all the gifts of diversity that each of us brings.
Yes.
I first heard that welcome statement spoken by Greg in August of 2001, before I began my field education as student pastor. As Greg made that statement, I could feel my spirit shift, appreciating both the joy of such a statement and the yearning to be in a world where such a statement would not be necessary. I felt in my heart that the words spoken moved beyond mere welcome to words of justice and and equity. I was able to sigh, relieved at finally having my blackness and womanness affirmed. Though progressives had not yet begun to use the word, I heard as well an invitation to intersectionality. Greg acknowledged in that statement that all oppression is connected. Amen?
Amen.
The full impact of those words continue to inspire and energize me. And because of so many of you are here today, I know that Greg's passion for justice and truth-telling has touched you as well. For that legacy, we are forever changed. Amen?
Amen.
I had the honor of serving in ministry with Greg for 6 years. In that time, he was, for me, a supervisor, a mentor, a colleague, and most of all, a friend. I answered my call to ministry late in life. Not sure what that even meant, I left my job and family in Michigan to come to seminary in Chicago. I found it a rewarding yet troubling experience. I heard words used like inclusion and diversity, words that on the surface felt really good. What was confusing is that I did not observe those words being lived out. I found seminary, though claiming to be inclusive, one of the most exclusive places I'd ever experienced. And then I met Craig Dell and the Broadway family, amen. Some of you have heard me talk about that first meeting. The seminary sent me to interview with Greg, and here I am, a black woman from a conservative religious background, sent to Boys Town without any background or knowledge of what that meant or who Greg Dell was. Of course, that was before Google. Because in my experience, pastors wore suits every day of the week. He takes me on a tour of the building, and in the process, it becomes clear to me, oh, this is the pastor. So he tells me about his trial and suspension for officiating a same-gender union service. And inside, I'm about to lose my mind trying to figure out what in the world have I gotten myself into. While on the outside, I'm smiling and nodding politely. Greg then invites me to experience a congregation before I make my final decision to do field education at Broadway. So the following Sunday, I attend, and that is when I first hear that community and connection statement. Greg, with passion and conviction, welcomes everyone into the room by naming identity. And I did not hear this naming as labeling. I heard it as an embracing of persons that too often are ignored or excluded in society, and in particular, the church. That invitation felt extremely personal to me and has made a huge difference in how I view myself in the world and how I understand ministry. As I reflect on Greg's ministry and our ministry together, I have so much to be thankful for. I am grateful that I had the opportunity to sit with this gentle, loving giant. A close friend of Greg's, a retired United Methodist pastor, Gil Caldwell, who actually was too ill to travel, I'm sure he would be here today, refers to Greg as a drum major for justice. A drum major for justice. I love that image. I also think of Greg as a modern-day prophet, one who spoke truth to power, not as a checkoff of work completed, but as one who internalized the true meaning of justice and attempted to live justly each and every day of his life. The words Greg spoke and the actions of his life existed in harmony. The truth he spoke was one of equity, was one of honesty, fairness, and integrity. Greg taught and modeled words like authenticity and inclusion. He taught liberation theology and lived what it meant to be free by claiming one's unique identity and empowering others to do the same. Greg modeled what it means to begin theology in original blessing rather than original sin. It means that life, all life, commences with celebration rather than condemnation. Greg preached this from the pulpit. He taught this in Bible study. He lived this in his relationships. Celebration of identity is fundamental in his justice journey. And so it is with a glad and sad heart that I celebrate this prophet named Greg Dell. It's critical to acknowledge prophets who stand up and out against injustice, regardless of the consequences. They are the revolutionaries of change. They are the energy that inspire justice seekers like you and me to stay on the journey through fear, through weariness, and often even through uncertainty. It is prophets like Greg Dell who give us strength and courage to call out oppressors and shine light on injustice wherever and whenever we experience it. The scripture I chose for today is about another prophet whose passion is also justice. The chapter begins with God telling Isaiah to assemble the people and deliver a personal message to them from God. The prophet was to shout, to speak as if a loud trumpet of alarm was sounding. Isaiah was to pull out all the stops and speak the truth frankly and boldly. Tell the people, Isaiah says, to stop pushing the disenfranchised around. Stop oppressing your workers. Remove the chains of injustice. Share your bread with the hungry. Welcome the stranger. Be repairers and restorers. As I studied this passage in Isaiah, a picture of Greg popped into my head. There was a picture last month on Facebook of Greg sitting on the front lines of Raleigh with a bullhorn in his hand just weeks before his death, shouting, speaking truth, calling out injustice. A drum major, indeed, and a prophet till the end. Amen.
Amen.
We live in a scary time. A time that feels like regression for many of us. We have marched and protested for voter rights, for marriage equality, for immigration reform, for the right of all people to have clean drinking water and health care and quality education and jobs with a living wage. For many of us, that feels very tentative in today's climate. So this past week, I've been asking myself, what would Greg do? And in that asking, I have realized that Greg has been sitting on my shoulders, speaking words of encouragement and challenge for all the years I've been in ministry. We lived it together for 6 years, and then talked a lot about it after his retirement. So here is what I believe Greg would do. First, I believe he would grieve. One of the things I learned early on from Greg is to not run from trouble. To not deny it or sweep it under the rug, but meet it face to face, weep, rage at it, acknowledge the pain. And then I believe he would connect with community, his family, his peers, his peeps. He would get a feel for what others are thinking, sharing pain and ideas, and then he would act. He would march, he would protest, he would contact people in power. He would use his privilege as a straight, white man to challenge oppressive ideology and legislation and laws. He would stand against the laws that privilege some while excluding others.
Yes.
He would tear down walls.
Yes.
And create alliances. And then he would focus his attention on rebuilding and restoring bridges of hope and love and liberation. That line in Isaiah that says, you will rebuild the ancient ruins and build up age-old foundations. You will be called repairer of broken walls and restorer of ruined neighborhoods. That verse is the very image of who Greg has been and the legacy that he leaves for us today. Amen?
Amen.
We too are called in this moment to be repairers and restorers. We are called to break the chains of injustice and break every yoke we encounter. We are called to share bread with all who are hungry, to be home for the homeless, and to satisfy the needs of the afflicted. That is what Greg devoted his life to. He knew in his heart of hearts that until all of us are free, none of us are free. Movement and resist, organizations that Greg loved and supported. We are called to shine a light on the injustices in our world. Often that call is unpopular and flies in the face of tradition. Sometimes in order to answer that call, we must ford the deep, icy rivers of bigotry and isolation. Sometimes we have to walk away from what is most comfortable and familiar. We lose friends, we lose family, we run the risk of losing our livelihood and even our life. And yet Greg will remind us that death never has the last word. The legacy that Greg leaves is a spirit of justice and hope and life. This spirit of life invites us to see the world and be in the world differently. I don't know about you, but I want a world where my identity is valued and where I can walk safely in that identity. I want to live in a world where my difference and my neighbor's difference is not seen through a lens of fear, but through a lens of peace, a lens that affirms that all that we are, all that we are, adds to the beautiful fabric of humanity. On this day of remembering and celebrating, I remember a man who wept over injustice. I remember a man who used his body and privilege to protest unfairness. I remember a man who believed that any rule or law that oppresses another is an unjust rule or law. I remember a man whose life was about loving neighbor as self and doing all that he could to make that a reality. Greg, your life speaks for itself. I have a great love and appreciation for you that will never die. You touch so many, and your legacy of love and justice will live on in and through each one of us. We celebrate you today, Greg. You taught us so well. So rest, my brother. We got this. We give thanks today for the life of Gregory Robert Dell. We remember him for the man he was, for the struggles he fought for us and with us, for the love and hope he so freely shared. Greg lives on through the many lives he touched, the common life of which we are all a part. We remember especially the family this day, Jade and Jason, Olivia, Ramona, Gloria, and Laura. May you find strength and peace in the memories we've shared, and may those memories bring comfort in your days to come. And now, as we say a final farewell to one we all held so dear, let us be comforted, trusting that life is full of meaning and purpose, even in death. For life is sacred. It is sacred in its being born. It is sacred in its living.
Amen.
give thanks and to celebrate. We are sent forth to be inspiration and challenge and connectors of justice and peace.